Good morning. And welcome to worship here at Shepherd of the Cross, where we are led by Christ and transformed by his love and his grace. First and foremost, before we get too much further, I want to issue a huge thank you to everyone who stepped up to the plate last week and that week in between Christmas and the New Year, whether you helped with worship in my absence, whether you picked up slack in the office, whether you transformed this space from Christmas into Epiphany. I admit, I was wowed when I came back and I saw the tree not only down, but put away. The nativity down and put away. I was impressed. So thank you for being the body of Christ that you are, and for together as we continue forward into a new year. As it is that we go forward from this new year, I had a colleague this past week mention to me that it seems like in the church year, Jesus is suffering from RAS, rapid aging syndrome. It's a little funny, but it's kind of true if they take the church year literally, because of how everything fell with Christmas, we actually don't get to celebrate here in worship, at least, the day of Epiphany. We'll be celebrating that with our women later tonight at our Epiphany party. But we jump forward to Jesus as he goes to the Jordan River today to be baptized. Last time I was with you, he was a baby. Now he's probably, I don't know, 8, 9 at least. Again, rapid aging syndrome. But holistically, as we continue forward in this season of Epiphany, we look for the ways in which Jesus is revealed to us. Here in worship, through sacraments, through scripture, and yes, through the gift of baptism. So on watch for Christ to be revealed to us, I invite us to rise as we join in our gathering song, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of darkness and light, word of truth, wind sweeping over the waters.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. You have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant. Renew your creation. Restore us that we might proclaim your good news to all.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, the voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. And Jesus, the reign of God, has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to God.
we join our voices in prayer? Let us pray. Holy God, creator of light and giver of goodness, your voice moves over the waters. Immerse us in your grace and transform us by your Spirit, that we may follow after your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation may be seated. And I'm going to invite the kids to come on up and join me here this morning to start us out. Good morning, dear friends. Thank you. Did you guys know that with some of the money that you guys have been offering as a part of your offering during the Christmas season, we were able to buy a bunch of animals? And those animals were sent to people around the world to help them make a living and also so that they would have food. So round of applause to you guys and to the congregation for helping us make a difference in God's good world as a part of what we do as a mission of this church. So, friends, I have to ask, did any of you guys wash your hands this morning already? Yes? When did you wash your hands? After you went to the bathroom? Anybody else? Yep. I wash my hands right away when I get up because my hands and my face always feel really grubby. Now, is that going to be the only time you wash your hands today? I hope not. It is flu season, which means we all need to be extra, extra careful. So it's kind of silly to think that you're only going to wash your hands once, right? We got to keep doing it. Well, today, friends, did any of you catch what special day today is that we're talking about in the life of the church? I only said it once, so. When Jesus got baptized, yes, so we call it baptism of our Lord, which is why our parents are still white, just like what they were at Christmas, because we keep our parents white to honor the majestic nature of who Jesus is for us. So in baptism, there's some washing going on, right? Do you think Jesus was baptized? Yeah, he was baptized just like us. So why do you think Jesus was baptized? I know, it's kind of a strange question, isn't it? Because he needed some water for his dogs. That it could be. Why do you think he was baptized? Maybe because he had original sin? Maybe. It's one of those kind of head-scratcher questions. And even adults like me scratch our heads at this a little bit because we believe that Jesus is God, right? And so if Jesus is God, he doesn't need to be forgiven of his sin, right? So maybe Jesus was baptized to show that he is like us. And just like us, he comes so that we can walk alongside of him, and he gives us an example to follow and something that we can be a part of together. But when we're baptized, we join with Christ, and we do believe that we are washed, and just like we wash away germs when we wash our hands, we believe that those things that keep us away from God and those things that keep us away from each other are washed away. So let's go around this baptism font for just a second. Let's go ahead and circle on up there. Do you want to come and join me? Let's go up by the baptismal font. And as we come around here, even though we're only baptized once, that only happened once, not like washing our hands, every single day we can remember our baptism anytime that we see water. There's, oh, good. At first I thought, didn't think there was water in there. There is water in there, good. Did you guys almost, is it hard to see the water? Is it just me? It's just pastor, okay, that's fine. It's all good. So what are some ways that we can remember a baptism? We can remember a baptism by coming to church. We can remember our baptism by learning about Jesus. We can remember our baptism by maybe praying with our family. We can remember our baptism by showing love to other people, by helping somebody out, by being kind. And we can remember our baptism by making the sign of the cross and remembering that we are beloved child of God. So why don't you guys go ahead and do that. Make a sign of the cross on your forehead. And I want you guys to repeat after me. We're all a little tired this morning. Wow. Okay. I am a beloved child of God. and sent to make a positive difference in the world. So, friends, if you guys remember anything, I'm going to have you guys be my messengers of God's love in just a minute. I want you guys and everyone in the congregation to remember today that you are a beloved child of God who's been baptized, and now you are being sent to make a positive difference in the world today. So I'd like you guys, if you are willing, dip your finger one more time in the font, and I want you to find a special person in the congregation and make a sign of the cross on their forehead and say, "You are a beloved child of God." And congregation, if you would like, turn to a neighbor next to you, making the sign of the cross on their forehead. You are a beloved child of God. Awesome. Perfect. Very good. Thank you, friends, for coming up today.
God, you have revealed yourself to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, your Word made flesh, who lived among us full of grace and truth. Open us to your revelation once again, that in these words of Scripture we might know your presence and follow in your light. Amen. Our first reading for today is likely quite familiar, the beginning of the story of creation. Out of chaos, God brings order. Out of formless void, God brings light. Though God first created long ago, God continues to create new life in our midst. May these words become the word of God for us. A reading from Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Please read Psalm 29 responsively with me. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Worship the Lord in holy splendor.
The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord over mighty waters. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and Syria like a wild ox.
The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forest bare. And in his temple, all say, "Glory."
The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forever.
May the Lord give strength to his people.
May the Lord bless his people with peace.
Our second reading comes from the book of Acts. At this point in the story, Paul has begun his missionary travels and is in the city of Ephesus. There he encounters people who had received John's baptism of repentance, but had never heard of the Holy Spirit or of baptism in the name of Jesus. Upon hearing this news of Jesus Christ, the people desire to be baptized and experience the Spirit's power anew. A reading from Acts chapter 19. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you, I am well pleased." The Gospel of our Lord. Grace and peace to you all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. By now, the Christmas decor has been taken down, both here at church, likely in our homes, and stores are transitioning just as quick as can be to the next holiday, which is Valentine's Day. Has anybody seen anything yet? Oh, gosh. Okay, well, maybe it's because I wasn't here last weekend here at Shepherd, but I felt the urge to keep the Christmas vibe going for just one more day. So, you may have noticed, if you've been around the sanctuary, I have two presents up here this morning. And so I'm going to invite Caleb and Kelsey to come on forward. And each of you, I'd like you to take one of those presents and stand one on each side of me. You guys cool with that? Now, Caleb and Kelsey, in your family, do you guys have any traditions when you open presents? Youngest to oldest, you do it one at a time. Okay, well, today we're going to break the rules. And today you guys both get to open at the same time. You can pretend you're the same age, okay? So here's the deal though. Congregation, I need you guys have a job in this too. I need you guys to watch and pay attention to how these two amazing kiddos are gonna open their presents. That's your job. Watch and pay attention. On the count of three, you can start. Are you ready? Are you ready? Ready? One, two, three, go. And once you get inside of it, go ahead and take a few things out of there. That's okay. There should be three things inside there. Okay. All right, let's look at what we got. I think that's everything, Caleb. Very good. Kels, very good. Oh, Kelsey just took a little bit more time. That's okay. All right, can you guys hold up the yellow sign for just a sec? What does this say? Beloved. Okay, what else we got? You have two batteries. Very good. And what else we got? A cross. All right, well, we'll come back to what's inside the box. Maybe it wasn't the newest iPhone or $1 million or what you were asking for Christmas, but it's something. We'll come back to that. But congregation, you guys had a job. Did you notice anything about how these two were unwrapping their gifts? Caleb was quick. Yes. And Caleb got his done faster. Anybody else notice anything? What did you notice, Jacob? What is that? Kelsey was slow. Yes. I noticed that some of Caleb's paper just went all over. Did anybody else notice that? Okay. Was either the way that Caleb or Kelsey opened their present the right way to open a present? I was hearing some laughter. Is there secretly, like, maybe there is? I'm seeing some head nods. Yeah? Yeah? I wonder if sometimes as we get older, sometimes it's a societally appropriate way to be more careful to open our presents. But maybe as a kid, we can just go through it as fast as can be. Yes? All right. I'm going to have you guys put your gifts down on the ground. Don't worry, I'll have your help in just a little bit again, but I'll have you guys take your seat. Let's give them a round of applause for being amazing helpers this morning. Go ahead. You guys can go back and stay with your family. It's all good. I mean, if you want to stay up here, that's okay. But... so as our two lovely helpers take their seats, I want to encourage us to push this just a bit further this morning. Because though it might seem a little strange to focus on how we open Christmas presents on a day we're celebrating the baptism of our Lord, as I read our gospel lesson earlier this week, I couldn't help but think that the way that God enters the scene in the Gospel of Mark is more like the way Caleb opened his present than the way Kelsey opened her present. Because contrary to what we heard in the Gospel of Luke back on Christmas Eve with the birth of Jesus, and contrary to the picturesque hallmark images of the Nativity being all so calm and so neat, nothing out of place, certainly nothing ripped open, here in the Gospel of Mark, we don't get any of that. Not even a mention of Christ's birth. Instead, God's first entrance in this story is when Jesus comes up out of the waters, where he is baptized by John, and then it's like bam, 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 things start to happen as the heavens are ripped apart, as a dove descends on Jesus, and a voice comes declaring Jesus beloved. The whole scene might end with a gentle word of assurance, a claim on Jesus as his identity, as God's son, as God's beloved, as God's chosen. The scene might end there. But God's first entrance into the world here in the Gospel of Mark is nothing short of dramatic. For in this moment, God is tearing open the heavens like Caleb opening a gift on Christmas morning. All to declare Christ beloved and to anoint Jesus with the Spirit, possessing him and filling him and giving him authority over all things as he is sent forth to embody the good news
And as he is given this revelatory power to unseat the powers of this world with the very power of God. The very power of God. That's what's bestowed upon Christ in baptism. The very same power that created in the beginning. The very same power that causes the oaks to whirl and shake the wilderness, the very same power that would make evil spirits cower in fear, the very same power that would defeat death, and the very same power that God would choose to reunite heaven and earth, you and I, with God's very being. Hear that again. God would choose to use this extraordinary power, this unimaginable power, to restore this weary world, this creation, so that you and I and all parts of God's creation might live in union with Christ. Going back to our present analogy, it's as if we are the present underneath all of that wrapping paper. And God is not holding back one bit from tearing through whatever it is that's on the outside of us just to get to us. Rather, God comes through all that stuff that we've wrapped ourselves with. Whether that stuff is our pride and our ego, whether that stuff is a protective layer around our heart, armor against being hurt, whether that stuff is our own apathy and contentment, or quite simply a different mask that we've put on over ourselves out of a sense that we have to be something that we're really not. Whatever that stuff is that we've wrapped ourselves with, God in God's power comes to tear through all of that, because God's care and God's love and God's desire to name us as sacred and beloved is just too strong to hold back that urge. So instead of holding back, as if God is like a kid on Christmas morning, tearing open the heavens and tearing through whatever it is that stands in the way of declaring you as beloved. Yes, you, dear friends, are God's beloved. All because God chose to act. And now, because of Christ's claim on you, you also have been united with Christ in Christ's baptism. For baptism isn't just a nice friendly bath that we receive once upon our lives at some point. Instead, through water and the word, we are united through Christ in his death and resurrection, also that we might be reborn and so that we might be living a new life with all this wrapping paper getting in the way. All this wrapping paper might as well go to the trash. But then here's the kicker. As people who have been united to Christ, as people who have been named beloved, guess what? We also have been given this power of the Holy Spirit. Perhaps not the power to defeat death. I think Jesus has taken care of that, thankfully, for us, but you too have been infused by this mind-boggling power that equips you to speak and to testify and witness and live as a co-worker with Christ in God's kingdom. Just think about that for a minute. God has equipped you and me with this power. And God has given you and me the responsibility, indeed the purpose, to live as baptized children of God, as heirs according to God's grace. Which, as much as that is a gift, friends, that is also a responsibility. A responsibility that we could walk away from. Or it wouldn't be that hard to do. And truth be told, in our sin and brokenness, all too often we do shirk away our responsibility to live into that baptismal call and to steward this incredible gift of God's grace that's been given to us. For I know I always haven't been the best steward of God's grace within me. It's easier just to ignore it or to install a plug into the system that inhibits God's grace from flowing out of me to those around me, especially certain people on given days. But, as people whom God was determined to get to, and as people whom God has named beloved, as people who have been united with Christ, and as people who have been given this extraordinary power, we, you, this congregation, were created for more. You and I were created and are called to walk forth in a spirit of repentance, transforming our hearts, and a spirit of joy and hope for all of creation. All of which sends us out of this sanctuary to live into our belovedness as now being active agents of God's grace. As now we become the people who are determined to tear through anything that divides us one from another. And to tear through anything that obscures God's presence in our midst. So, since this seems to be our last hurrah of Christmas for the year, I do actually have one more present for us this morning. So Caleb and Kelsey, you guys mind coming back up one more time? Okay. I hid this one because I didn't want you to see it. But before you open it this time, I'd like you guys to turn around, face the congregation. If you guys wouldn't mind, there's a lot of words on that present, aren't there? What words do you see? Anger? Jealousy? Greed? Violence? What is that? Fear? Unwillingness to be transformed, misuse of power, comparison, what's on this side? Individualism, judgment. We could keep going on and on, friends, if we wanted to. And there are so many things that stand in the way between us and other people, and stand in the way of obscuring God's presence that is trying so hard to come into our midst. So this time, friends, I want both of you to tear through that paper, just as God came tearing through to you, as we tear through all this stuff that stands in our way. Go for it. Two people tearing might not be quite as dramatic as one person tearing. I admit, I didn't completely think this through. And there is something inside this box, too. And if you guys would turn it on, you guys know how to turn this on? Woo, you guys want to, like, drape it over yourselves for a minute? Oh, isn't that cute? That's so cute. All right, if you want to stand up, Caleb, that's cool. Truth be told, I didn't know exactly what to put in this second box, because as we tear through all this stuff that stands in our way of being together as a body of Christ, and as we tear through all this stuff that stands in the way of obscuring God's presence in our lives, in our world, and even in the church, we're going to stumble upon a lot of good things. But I have a feeling that as we live into our belovedness more and more, we will find ourselves infused with God's light. And more, we will find ourselves taking that light into the world, transforming the world according to God's grace. Can we pray? Most holy and powerful God, we thank you for tearing through every layer just to get to us, to claim us as your beloved, and for breaking into our lives, our world, and our church. Open us to receive the Spirit you have given us. Give us the zeal to live as agents of your grace so that nothing obscures your one true light. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord, we pray. Amen. Do you want to keep the lights? No. I tell you what, I'll take the lights. We'll maybe even put them up on the altar. Very good. And we will continue as we sing together. Thanks, friends. As our hymn told us, we have been baptized with the Spirit, and we too have been marked with the cross of Christ forever. Within the Lutheran Church, we have the opportunity to affirm our baptism and our baptismal calling. Often this practice is reserved for special times, especially in the lives of youth and of young adults, after they have gone through a series of instruction, thinking about what they believe and their faith. But it is also possible, and I dare say right, for us to reaffirm our baptismal calling and our commitment to live as people who have been gifted this power and now are committed to taking this power forth from this place. So this morning, after we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, I'm going to ask, if you do so choose, to reaffirm your commitment to live as a baptized child of God as you take this power of God's grace into the world. If you respond or not is totally up to you. This is your covenant with Christ as you live as a follower of Jesus. Let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Together, you all have made public profession of your faith. Do you now intend to continue in the covenant that God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people, following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If so, I invite you to respond as you desire. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. And as fellow companions on our journey, do you promise to support and pray for one another in your life in Christ? If so, and if you are inclined, I invite you to respond, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth. Cleanse us from sin and raise us to new life. Stir up within your people here the gift of your Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
Trusting the Spirit's work among us, I invite us to pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Let us pray. Most holy and powerful God, thank you for tearing through every layer just to get to us and claim us as your own. Continue to break into our midst, into our lives, our worlds, our schools, our workplaces, our churches, our relationships, to help perceive what you are doing to make all things new. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Most holy and powerful God, through you comes the breath of life. Renew your creation and inspire us to live as stewards of the beauty and wonder that surrounds us. Lord, in your mercy, most holy and powerful God, even amidst chaos, you bring order. Surround the community of Perry as they reel from acts of violence that shook their city earlier this week. Bring comfort to those who grieve. Surround students and teachers with your protection. And grant to all your peace that goes beyond all human understanding. Lord, in your mercy, most holy and powerful God, by your word you create life. Bring healing and wholeness to those who suffer. This morning we remember Thelma, Margaret, Debbie, Harper, Philip, Shane, Aaron, Stacy, Jackson, Perry, Evelyn, Rick, Mark, Jim, Mike, Julia, Caitlin, Virginia, Rick, Betty, Marlis, Glenda, and those we name silently or aloud.
Oxalina, Sonoma, Rich.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Most holy and powerful God, you know our thoughts and needs better than we ourselves. Accept the prayers we now offer to you and strengthen us to do your will with joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to share God's peace with those around you. As we continue our worship this morning, we continue by receiving our offering, giving to God the gifts in which God has given to us for the building of his kingdom in our midst. Please rise. And we pray. Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Bob. Through the season of Epiphany, just one note. Sorry, I didn't give you a heads up on this. Through the season of Epiphany, do note for the congregation that in our Eucharistic prayer, I will be inviting the congregation to respond as with the great mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Please repeat that. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Follow my lead. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of the star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt,
the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life, so that all the world might see your light. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim together the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live in the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Join our prayers with your servants of every time and place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Gathered into one by the Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, God's will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome to come and participate in this sacrament of God's grace given for us. All are welcome to receive the bread with open hands and either the wine or the grape juice in the center of the trays. Come, for all is now ready.
You take away the sin of the world.
Please rise. And we pray. O morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with this heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, and every day, that we tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Dear friends, may the God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And may the blessing of our God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. We sing this little light of mine. Congregation, you can be seated for a few announcements before we go out and let our light shine for a while. Speaking of lights, all women of the congregation and those outside the congregations, your family, your friends, whomever, of all ages, are invited to join us for our Women's Epiphany Party tonight as we remember this light of Christ that's come into our midst. We're going to have some fun. We're going to have some fellowship. We'll have a brief devotion together. And you're invited to bring a few things. One thing I forgot, so this is really important. The first thing that has been failed to get out there in communications. If you're coming, bring an appetizer or something we can munch on. It's meant to be kind of a munchy, dinnery kind of time. So bring an appetizer to share. Also, bring a white elephant gift for white elephant gift exchange. And if you're so inclined, we, as women of the church, and also the entire congregation through the month of January, are invited to bring gifts of winter outerwear that will be shared with people in our community who need coats and hats and boots and gloves and everything else to keep warm, especially as we anticipate snow this coming week. So that starts tonight at 5 p.m. Is that right? Am I remembering that, women of the congregation, 5 p.m.? I hope so. Okay, sounds good. We're going to be here at 5. I just made a decision. Okay. Wednesday night, we start with Family Faith Nights again, starting over at Grace. Please come and join us, even if you haven't been a part of us to this point. Also, as we look to the new year, we're also looking to our annual meeting as a congregation. By next Sunday, we'll have annual reports ready to share with the congregation. And then 2 weeks after that, on the 28th, we will have our meeting immediately following worship, in which we will take care of the business of the congregation and also celebrate what the past year has been for us. To help celebrate, I believe our social team is helping with a potluck. Sign up in the back if you would like to offer something to bring as a part of that. Main dish, side, dessert, what have you.
And with that, with social team, Colleen, would you mind sharing a little bit more about some other stuff going on? Thanks, Glenn. Yes. One other announcement for me, and on behalf of the office, one thing that we are in the process of making sure that people who use offering physical offering envelopes have them for the new year, know that Kathy and I will be working out that this coming week. If you're here and you're like, I want a set of envelopes, talk to Kathy after worship, and she might be able to help you out even quicker than I can about that. So talk to Kathy. She'll be able to help you out faster than I can. Any other announcements from the congregation? Go in peace. You are God's beloved. Thanks be to God.